Good afternoon. My name is Dong Hun Kim, and I'm working at AEI in the smaller group led by Yan Bei Chen. The talk I'm going to give is about one special approach to compute the cell force in curved space-time. You might find some overlap with the Leo Varrock's talk given on Tuesday. While Leo gave the general survey of the radiation reaction and cell force, I'm going to focus particularly on a modesum approach to compute cell force. Sorry about. Is it readable? In this PowerPoint, sorry about that. So first, why is it meaningful to compute the cell force? Why is it interesting? So as many people have said already, we have a possible target for LISA detection, which is its mass ratio in fiber. And to describe wave, theoretical waveform accurately from this source, we need to describe the evolution, orbital evolution of the small black hole. We need to describe the orbital evolution of this small black hole accurately enough, including the effect of radiation reaction or the cell force. So before we continue discussion on this cell force, we need to make clear what the cell force is physically. The cell force roughly speaking, it's a self-interaction with the particle. So this small black hole will have this field diverging out from it. And in curved space-time, when this small black hole is moving around this big black hole, this field line, part of this field line, will actually act on the particle itself. Then, with this interaction of its own field, the particle actually will deviate from its original geodesic. So cell force is the interaction of the particle with its own field, and depending on the charge, it could be scalar, electromagnetic, and gravitational. And then it does change the world line of the particle away from geodesic. And then also importantly, it has some other meaning in terms of the motion of the particle. So the first, the part of the cell force, which we frequently actually refer to as radiation reaction, gives the information that how angular momentum and the energy are transported. While the rest of the cell force refers to as it's referred to as the conservative effect. And then it gives the description of the fatal, sorry, the change of the phase in the orbital evolution. So in formula, we can write down the cell force in a very simple form of the equation, taking the example of the scalar field. The cell forces, like in classical mechanics or electrodynamics, is simply charge times the field derivative, where this field is a self field, which does not include the singular part, so that we have some finite convergence, the value from that equation. So how do we formulate the cell force more detail? There have been theoretical study on these cell force in a very formal scheme in terms of equations of motion through three generations. So Dirac was the first one who suggested this problem as the electron moving in flat space-time. And he concluded that the electron moving in flat space-time actually does not undergo any cell force. In the next generation, Dwide and Brehm extended the Dirac's idea to the curved space-time and found that if the electron was moving in curved space-time, it would undergo cell force. And more recently, Mino Sasaki Tanaka and Kinan Ward extend this idea to the gravitational space and found the equation of motion to the gravitational cell force. And the Queen most lately found the scalar cell force equation in curved space-time. So I just give the easiest example among these, which is Queen's model of the scalar cell force equation of motion. As you see, you have the cell force, mass time self-acceleration, the left-hand side. And right-hand side, you have some non-relativistic, I'm sorry, non-general relativistic terms up to actually the second term. Yeah. Plus, you have some general relativistic terms represented by this rich tensor curvature and curved space-time retarded Green function. What can we see from this equation motion roughly? The most important thing is that we have this integral term, which is the integration of this retarded Green function over the history of the particles motion. We call this term as state integral term. And what this state integral term gives us is actually in the absence of incident field, in the absence of external field, having this state integral term, or together with this the geometry dependent terms, we will have non-vanishing the self-acceleration and the self-force term. The left-hand side, as a result of solving this integral differential equation. Then we can say that scalar cell force exists in curved space-time, and then radiation reaction occurs even when the particle is moving in free fall in the absence of this instance field. But the difficulty with this general formal scheme. As I said, this is integral differential equation. And it has been known that determination of this Green function is extremely difficult. Although some people in high energy theory have tried to determine this for very simple geometry, having maximally symmetry, like the expansion, like in the expansion model. But in general, determining this Green function for the popular geometry we have, Schwarzschild curve, is impossibly difficult to determine. Then how can we implement the calculation of cell force? So we may get back to this simple formulation of the cell force. So we have this physical picture that if we can possibly determine this the cell field, we can always compute this cell force as charge time derivative of the cell field. So we are going to use that idea, and then Baragenori and Mino Nakano and Sasaki, and also my past, my ex-actually research group in Florida, found a scheme to calculate the cell force using this so-called Modison regularization technique. So what we do in this technique is we find the retarded and the singular part separately, and we subtract singular part from the retarded field to remove the singularity, and we finally end up with some nicely convergent the regular remainder part. But each of these retarded part and singular part has singularity when you take the field point to the particle point. So at the location of the particle, these two quantities are divergent and become infinite. Then how can you possibly represent these quantities in the neighborhood of the particle source point? We can use spherical harmonic decomposition, and we divide these quantities into very small pieces. And the retarded part of this harmonic decomposition can be determined numerically. In fact, by solving the wave equation, this wave equation, we can find this spherical harmonic pieces of the retarded part. Whereas this singular part can be determined fully analytically. The method actually I'm going to show later. So once we find these two pieces separately, we actually subtract one from the other. And multiplying by the spherical harmonics and taking the limit, we can find L mode of the retarded part and the L mode of the singular part of the force. And still, this L mode retarded and L mode singular part are finite individually. And then just taking this term to some good large number, we can find this cell force at the location of the particle. So this is brief description how Modison is done, how the Modison calculation is done, and particularly these parameters A, B, and C, D are termed regularization parameters, which makes the whole computation finite and convergent. So here is a brief description how the numerical part is done, how the retarded L mode is found. So roughly, we solve this wave equation. And this wave equation has this source term here. And we need to specify what orbit we have, for what orbit we want to solve this equation. So taking example, suppose we have the circular orbit having radius r naught with constant angular frequency omega about the Schwarzschild background. We have this simple the coordinates of the duality. And then plugging back here, we can simplify the source term. And then having this constant frequency, we have actually some rotational symmetry, and we can represent this source term in terms of spherical harmonic pieces. In the same way, we can do it we can decompose the left-hand side using the spherical harmonic basis. And then this wave equation actually reduced to just the R component of this the ordinary second order differential equation. And then by imposing boundary conditions at the event horizon and its infinity, taking only ingoing waves at the event horizon and outgoing to the infinity, we can determine this spherical harmonic component of the retarded part. And then finally, with that retarded part determined numerically, we can find L mode of the retarded surface by taking the sum over L. And how is the analytical part is done? How is the singular part of the circle is done? This is work that I have done before. And also Barak's group and some other groups have done this in a different way. So the singular part of the circle is represented by these regularization parameters, having this mode weight here. So this L mode of the surface is roughly speaking is L mode decomposition of this self field, so singular field derivative. And most effectively, you can represent this singular field in terms of in the form of the Coulomb potential, where you have the neighboring distance using this spatial normal coordinate. The spatial normal coordinate is nothing but the distance between the field and source point weighted by this geometrical factor and boosted by four velocities of the particle. So skipping all the details, we get these quantities for regularization parameters, A, B, and C terms. And then combining two results. For the easy example, the scalar surface and circular orbit over the solid background, you can get this the graphical result. As you see, by subtracting more and more the regularization parameters, you see the more obvious the convergence patterns of the graph. And for the configuration of the the radius 10 times of the central black one, summed to 40 of the L, we get this amount of the surface calculated. Can you extend this scheme to gravitational case? Yes. Instead of solving the scalar wave equation, we'll solve the perturbed Einstein equation. But there is some problem with this gravitational surface. There is some conceptual problem. The Mino Sasaki Tanaka spin and world gravitational surface, their formulation is not actually gauge invariant. And that depends on the choice of the gauge. Then how can you possibly recognize the surface for the gravitational case? We can instead find some gauge invariant quantities, and then we can determine the changes in gauge invariant quantities due to the surface effect. So for instance, the circular orbit problem, we can actually define some direct observable omega, which is orbital angular frequency, or the combination of this omega with energy and angular momentum. And then there are quantities in this perturbed geometry have this expression, where you have the perturbed field or field derivative. And this perturbed field or field derivative can be treated using Moltzmann regularization technique and so using tensor spherical harmonic decomposition. So in the same way, we can determine these perturbed quantities. And then once we determine these quantities, we can determine these the change in these observables due to the surface effect. Can you also extend this scheme to Kerr? It has known to be very difficult, especially in the strong field resin. It's extremely difficult to determine the retarded part of the part of the Einstein equation. But we can simplify the problem, taking weak field and weak spin limit. The the Kerr geometry almost reduced to some spherical background, like Schultz geometry, where you have new geometry in time and azimuthal angle, having this spin effect here, A. And then in this new geometry, you can treat the problem as if you treat the Schultz problem, where you have the radius and the equatorial plane, and then some azimuthal evolution, where you have the fixed angular frequency in terms of the frequency, as if you have no spin effect, plus some spin effect. And then again, using the mode sum technique, we can find retarded part out of this field equation. And also, we can determine the singular part. And subtract one from the other, we can determine the self force for the curve. Here, show the example of the singular part, the curve case, that we have A and B systems, just like we have these for the Schultz problem. And they are determined to be these quantities, looking very complicated, but they can be actually more specified given the information of the conditions. And then we can actually think of the extension of this scheme to the gravitational self force in curve, so, trying to solve this part of the Einstein equation and trying to determine this, the retarded field there, and also determine the singular part of this field and subtract, removing those singular parts out of this retarded field. We can possibly calculate the change of the rate of change of energy and the angular momentum, again, using the Mode sum technique. And here I put briefly some problems we have with the self force. In the Mode sum technique, actually, we don't really include the self force effects in the orbital evolution. Like, we haven't found the method that actually reflects the self force effect that gives rise to the deviation of the geodesic. And also, this was discussed by the Leo's talk also, in the Leo's talk. So, secular dephasing effect due to this conservative self force versus the adiabatic approach. So, this is about the time scale we are calculating self force. In the adiabatic approach, we have much longer time scale, so about a year, but in this mode sum technique, we have much shorter time scale, about weeks. So, determining these effects, whether it's meaningful or not, some people actually argue that the error due to this dephasing effect is negligible in this adiabatic approach. But we have to see. And also, developing techniques for the curve, separation curve in the strong field resin has to be done. What I have tried here is only for the weak field, weak spin problem, but we are more interested in this strong field resin, and we have to develop better numerical techniques to determine this retarded part. Yeah, that's it.
Some ways from having the diagnostic. Like, your job, we think about. estimates of the self force. Mm-hmm. Is there any way to estimate the accuracy of these? That is there any way, is there any reasonable theoretical way to get an independent calculation somehow that we can compare against in certain, I mean, clearly one has to make a number of approximations to make the problem tractable. It would be nice to have some sense of how good these approximations are.
One thing I can think of is we can compare the result from this method with the result from post-Newtonian approximation. So actually this is good arena. The last example I gave is for the weak field resin. So you can actually do the similar calculation.